before I hear it, loser. I'm giving the guards a chance to follow up on them from that side, just because they have, in the past, they prefer to, once they start their game drive, go to those sorts of sightings that are outside the lodge first, and then the rest of the vehicles start to move in, which makes absolute sense. I just want to double check. I wouldn't be surprised. It hasn't been baking hot today in the slightest. It's actually been fairly cool. So there's a chance that they could have been moving about even after we left them on the sunrise safari. Even though they were looking particularly flat and tired, I still think they might have wandered about. That's the plan. That's what we're up to at the moment. Oh, flies fluttering about. The flies have also been something. They've been a consequence of the rain. One of these brand new baby flies that have just completed their metamorphosis and become adults. And all presenters and cameramen have been commenting on them. Brian, you've got a few fluttering about you there.
I've got thousands here.
I've got an entourage around me. It's all part of being in the bush. Definitely not a big deal, a big problem. I think those of you who've been watching since at least sort of the time that I started last year will know that of all of us, there's one presenter that gets plagued more than others and in fact gets the most irritated out of all of us. And that, of course, is Steph. Now, Steph, being the bush genius that he is, came up with a very interesting plan to keep the flies away, and I'll tell you about it in a second. I'm just going to stop and have a look quickly at this male. Ooh, there we go. We've done our very subtle stop approach. I'm very aware of the sand in the brake discs. That's what's causing the squeaks. Very difficult to do anything about, unfortunately. Off he goes. A magnificent-looking male impala. I must say that the males are looking really good. Compare and contrast. You do have the opportunity. Take note of what the male impala look like now at the beginning of April and see what they look like at the end of June. You're going to notice a tremendous difference between the start of the rut and the end of it. Is basically what happens within the rutting season itself is that the males expend, especially males of this age, he's coming up to 4 years old, he's almost fully grown. His horns haven't quite completed their upward turn, but he is quite a large-bodied male impala. He will spend the next 2 months fighting off, chasing away other males, attempting to collect a group of females, and then mating with them. And the females, I must say, show a certain reluctance to accept the attentions of the males. They go dashing off into nowhere. And this morning we had an incredible sighting of them on quarantine, being herded by one particular large male. Unfortunately, in my opinion, getting started, peaking a little bit too early. He has very cleverly managed to collect his harem, got his ladies all to himself, but he's just actually done it a little bit too soon. Oh. Impala just got a little bit of a fright there. That could have been anything from the wind blowing to a leaf moving. I'm not sure what startled him there. But yes, that male was peaking too soon, investing too much energy before the females are actually ready to mate. And as a result, he might actually miss out on the opportunity when they do get to the point where they are ready to mate with the males. And the male impala, he'll have a window of 7 days, if that, at which he will be able to collect a group of ladies, mate with them, fend off all other males. And during that time, he will not eat, he will not sleep, he will not groom, he will drink. They'll have to drink. But that is what he will spend that time doing. And by the end of 6, 7, 8 days, he's just too exhausted to carry on. And the next male sweeps in, takes over, and starts the process again. Keeping the genetic line nice and fresh and snappy and free of inbreeding. Oh, it's just other. I could see movement far away in the bushes there, but it's just other impala. So yes, take note is what I mean of what the male impala look like now. The other physiological effect that I'm seeing is, not to put too fine a point on it, their testicles have increased in size probably by about a third. So they've got a lot bigger. They haven't, I would not go so far as to say they've doubled in size, but they have definitely increased in size. And it's an interesting physiological effect because you can clearly see the impact that the breeding season actually has on an animal like an impala. And that's not something you would see in, for example, kudu, that have no set breeding pattern. Nyala, they breed all year round. And I think it is just because once that impala does get those females, he has such a limited chance to pass on his genes. And at the end of it all, that's basically what most organisms out here, most at least animals, set out to reproduce and to pass on their genetics to the next set of, or the next generation. Here we go. I knew I saw you moving here. Oh my goodness, but you are so tiny and you're very hidden. Let me try. Here's a steenbok. It wasn't an impala, it was a steenbok I was seeing from that side. I think that might be as good as it's going to get. Hello, little one. And I'm sure he thinks all of the goings-on of the impala are fairly ridiculous, since as a little male steenbok, he has his lady, and he will have the lady for the rest of his life in his small little territory, basically about 300 square meters. Ooh, what do you think he's doing there? I can tell you what he's doing. Unique amongst steenbok. No other antelope species really does this. And look how concentrated he is in what he's doing. He's digging, but he's digging for a very specific purpose. And you see how his tail's lifted a little bit there? It's because he was just defecating. And steenbok are the only little antelope that bury their dung. Nobody knows exactly why they do it. Some believe that because they've got such tiny territories that they move about in, it just helps to keep them a little bit more secret and cryptic by hiding the scent a little bit. Either way, it's an interesting aspect of their behavior. But yes, unlike the impala and their interesting, intricate lives, the steenbok leads a relatively simple, monogamous one. And in fact, you'll probably find his lady friend is grazing or browsing somewhere very close to him here. And although they do move about separately during the day, they were never really that far from each other. But just like the impala, however, the males have horns, the females do not. Now, the only time he might acquire another female is if his mate were to die, or vice versa in her case. Something we've spoken about before with these dwarf antelope species, all of the dwarf antelope, so that includes Dacre in this particular area, all of the dwarf antelope are monogamous, but some of them, not all of them, but some of them are unfaithful. So if, for example, another female were to move into the outskirts of his territory and he were feeling, if he was a steenbok inclined towards being unfaithful, he would take the chance to mate with her. But not all of them do. The same applies for the females. The females will also mate with sort of roaming males and then return to their mate and raise the offspring as his own. But it doesn't occur with all of them. There's no set pattern to which steenboks or which dacres will be unfaithful and which won't. Funny little aspect of their lives, that. I'm gonna see if I can't spot the female for you as well. That's not the female, that's the male. I'll go still a male. Hello, little one. Ruth, who is watching in Costa Rica, and the reason I've turned my engine off is because Ruth would like to know about the difference between a steenbok and a duiker. And while I explain it to you, Ruth, I'm going to just grab my mammal book, which luckily is right on top here, and I'll find the pictures for you whilst I chat to you. So steenbok and duiker are very, very similar in size and very easily confused if you are unfamiliar with them. Once you get to know the differences, however, you'll find that it's really easy to distinguish between the two. First of all, duiker have a slightly longer, slightly flatter back. They are a longer looking antelope, and actually if you look at them really carefully, they're a bit larger than the steenboks themselves. Whereas with the steenbok's body, it curves downwards. They've got almost a curved back. Let me just find this page for you. Bear with me one second. The other physical difference is the ears of the steenbok. So this is the animal that we were looking at now. They also have a slightly, in general, I talked about the body shape and the slight curve to the bottom, but in general they also have a slightly less lengthened nose. So they have a shorter nose than that of the duiker. Let me just see if I can't find for you in an obvious position. And just while I'm here, because I do have it here, this is a little antelope species that I promise you if we saw out here, we would all be jumping for joy. But it's another one that you could confuse with steenbok and duiker. The biggest difference with the Sharpe's grysbok is that it's flecked. It's not that clear in this picture, but it's very clear in real life. It looks as though it's going grey. Looks like a steenbok that's going grey. It's got really salt and pepper style fur. Lots and lots of white in it. So that's another little antelope that we could confuse with the steenbok and the duiker. But let's just, for completeness sake, find the duiker, which is a good direction. I checked my index because I was going in completely the wrong direction. Here we go, the common duiker. So a slight upward slope rather than the downward slope and curve of the steenbok. And quite a long, pronounced face. Their noses are much more pronounced than a steenbok. And both females and males have this tiny mohawk sitting up between either their horns or, in the case of the females, between their ears. So those are the main difference between duiker and between steenbok. You know, I could tell you that duiker are slightly bigger than steenbok. It's not that easy though when you're watching through the camera, where you don't really get that perspective of scale. Steenbok's ears, a little bit rounder, whereas same as with the duiker, slightly more elongated than that of a steenbok. It's interesting though that they are basically... It is interesting how different types of antelope have evolved. In the case of the steenbok and the duiker, they both have exactly the same lifestyle, exactly the same habitat. They basically fill precisely the same ecological niche, and yet they are two totally distinct, totally separate species. As we come around this corner, there is a very, very high chance or high possibility that there will be a herd of impala in front of us. In fact, I now will be devastated if there is not. They have been there every time I've driven around this corner in the last 10 days. And then we can stop and just have a look at the dynamics. Oh, come on, impala, don't choose this one day not to be here, please. Live wildlife filming. No, wait. Oh, no. Nope, okay. So usually we come around this corner and we have a herd of impala to chat about. But I'm going to answer James Richard's questions anyway, just even though we haven't managed to locate them. I was hoping it would be slightly different. But James, you were wondering what the chances are of a male impala dying from the sheer exhaustion of the rut. And the answer is relatively slim. They're unlikely to die from that. However, the mortality rate of male impala drastically increases. I was hoping these birds were going to fly towards us. Oh, ah, the one that would have just flew away from us. A couple of bee eaters fluttering about. Brian, as always, showing us his incredible camera skills. The European bee eaters are starting to gather together in preparation for their migration back, and in fact, most of them have already left. We're just seeing the stragglers now. Not the best view, however. But James, the chances of them dying of exhaustion, relatively slim. The chances of them being so distracted that they haven't noticed the leopard or the lion coming up behind them, much, much higher. And they are noisy. You heard already the amount of noise that the male impalas are making at each other, that deep grunting cough sound that is such an anathema to how we imagine such delicate antelope to behave and comport themselves with dignity in that way. They don't seem to at all. So whilst it's not really the exhaustion, it's kind of the exhaustion that kills them, because even if they are on alert and they have seen that leopard or lion stalking them, they're just don't quite have the resources needed to be able to escape them. So the death rate or the mortality rate of male impala at this time of year is the highest it will ever be for a time period in the year. Just as the mortality rate for the females is at its highest when they are right before they give birth, when they are heavily, heavily pregnant. Because again, they haven't exhausted themselves, but they are pregnant and struggling with the resource provision. We've got lots of birds fluttering about here. Let me try and stop for the one that I would like to spot. Earlier we saw a fork-tailed drongo, and that sort of loops around to Lucy's question. Lucy would like to know if we have mockingbirds in South Africa, and the answer is we don't, but I'm just trying to think about the family that the mockingbird belongs to. And I've never been to the States, I've never seen a mockingbird. Lucy, are mockingbirds imitators? I feel as though they might be. That might have given them their name. In other words, they imitate the sounds of the world around them. I'm pretty sure they are. In that case, whilst we don't have mockingbirds of that particular standard, we do have members of the same family and birds that exhibit the same trait. And in particular, I'm thinking of the fork-tailed drongo, which we see. Oh, that was unfortunate. I didn't see those green parrots there. Oh, they're gonna fly far away. Up into that dead tree at the back. Sorry, Lucy, I will get to your question in one moment. So, Lucy, the imitation ability of the mockingbird is seen in particularly the fork-tailed drongo. Let's see if we can't move around there, get a slightly different view. The fork-tailed drongo loves to imitate the sounds of other birds. In particular, they like to imitate cuckoos at a time when cuckoo might be looking to, being brood parasites, might be looking to lay their eggs in a fork-tailed drongo's nest. And what the male fork-tailed drongo does is he sits and he sings his heart out, but he sings the song of another male cuckoo, which in turn intimidates any of those cuckoos that might be trying to move into the area to parasitize his nest. Really clever little bird, and they've been known to fool even the greatest and best and most experienced twitchers and bird watchers around the world. Oopsie daisy. Hello, Jackson, you were a surprise. How's it? How's it been? Hey, Jackson. Hi, guys. Oh, you took me by surprise.
Yes, sir. I can see the area before I can see you.
Whatever.
Anything this side?
Not that I've seen. Just in Kumbi on the western edge of quarantine. I don't know if he's still about. He was a bit skittish.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks. did you come from, Impala Plains?
Yeah, I've come from Impala Plains. I'm going to go back towards those Nkumas. I think they're going to come on tonight.
Oh, okay, let us know.
They were hungry. I'll keep you updated. I'm going to go back there now.
Cheers.
Cheers, guys. Bye-bye. What was I chattering away about before I nearly drove into Tucson and had a car accident?
Birds.
Thank you, Brian. Imitating birds. Some of the scrub robins are also... one such example. Well, there was a bird sitting there. Unfortunately, I was too slow. Too slow to capture it. Oh well. I'm trying to find another good example of a good mimic that I could actually show you as opposed to just tell you about. But there are some very good mimics out there. Jeffrey, who is watching in Texas, has sent for a little bit more information about the mockingbird. It's only found in North America. It's endemic to there. And it is the state bird of Texas, apparently. And Jeffrey's even heard them imitating the call or the ring of a cell phone. I've heard drongos do that once with a cell phone ring. And it was at, funnily enough, it was at a bush camp that I used to occasionally work at. And it would imitate the first few notes. I can't remember exactly how it went, but it took me forever to figure out. And this bird kept doing it day after day, and I couldn't figure out which bird species was making this lovely whistle. And I finally tracked down and found the drongo sitting away, happily chirping, imitating a phone call type ring. Incredible. Then drongos, of course, also known for turning that to their advantage. They turn it to their advantage. The famous story, of course, being the fork-tailed drongo imitating the alarm call of the meerkats in order to get them to drop their food and to run back into their burrows. And I'll finish that story in a second. I just want to comment on these butterflies before they disappear off. Debbie, you were wondering, you're seeing the butterflies flutter around happily behind around us, and you were wondering which particular kinds are out and about. These look are the African vagrants, or occasionally termed African migrants as well, funnily enough. And there's one more there, Brian, if you look further down. It's a little bit closer towards us. Perfect, thank you. Those two there, that beautiful one there, is known as a blue pansy. Isn't it stunning? The symmetry in butterflies are absolutely beautiful. You know, of course, that Brent has a particular, what is the word? I want to say interest, perhaps passion, for the various butterfly species. I know that he does focus quite heavily on them. Debbie, there's also the African monarch butterfly, which I've seen quite a few of fluttering about. They tend to stay less still than the others. And then I've also seen a couple of citrus swallowtails. And there was one other one that I saw, and I can't remember what it was now. I've definitely seen other species. Oh, there's a beautiful one at the back there. I'm not sure which one that is. I just caught the glimpse of it. Brian, brilliant spotting there. Come back, butterfly. Just see the tips of its wings coming out. It looks like a solid yellow butterfly. I'm not too sure which one that is. And speaking of the butterfly expert, Brent has found more elephants to show you, so why don't you jump on the back of the vehicle with him?
We have found ourselves in a traffic jam. Best type of traffic jam out here, in my opinion. Nice, big, hilly traffic jam. They're heading straight north down our eastern boundary. Let's see if we can get a bit closer. Lovely little ones in there. We decided to just show you that almost beautiful, that beautiful straight line of them. Now, a lot of our old viewers will know I'm quite fond of a game that I play with everyone, and that's called the collective noun game. So what was the original collective noun for a group of elephants? So if you know the original colonial collective noun for a herd of elephants, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What was the original collective noun for a herd of elephants? And look at this, they're very nice elephants. It looks like they're turning into Juma, not out of Juma. Now, of course, as wonderful it is, you can see that the elephants have definitely made tracking a little bit harder if there were any tracks here. And an update on tracks before we get right in amongst these ellies. Last tracks of Queen Karula, unfortunately, crossed south out of our traverse area. Oh, yes, very, very scary. There you go. There's one. I got the little one, got a little bit left behind, youngish female, that trumpeting. But again, you must look at the general state of most of the elephant herd, and you can see none of them are really showing any signs of being too upset with our presence. The ones in front of us are just trooping on. So always remember, for those of you who ever visit the Kruger, put your vehicle into low range when driving around elephants. Although this might seem counterproductive because it's slower, the vehicle noise isn't as harsh. So sometimes just the bad driving and revving of engines and stuff can really upset. There we go. Ready for the next trumpet, little one? Slight panic. Run into the road. So bad driving can really upset these amazing creatures. Now, if any of these particularly big females like that one there show me any signs that they are not happy with our presence, then we will definitely leave. But they're definitely on a mission. They're going somewhere. You see, there's one female there who doesn't look very relaxed. Oh, she's moved off now. And you see the most of them, specifically the big ones, probably the matriarch, seems very, very relaxed. Mixed group, you've got quite a few different ages in there. Okay, they seem to have slowed down a little bit, so let's try to get a bit closer. Wood waterhole, unfortunately. That's the closest sort of permanent water to where we are. It's okay, hello. Although it looks like they might have already been to a waterhole, or mud wallow at least, at some point during the day. Oopsie. feeding off a marula tree at the moment. Sorry about that, guys. I've lost my communications. Let's give me a second to fix it. There we go. There we go. I can hear everyone again. Well done to Patty and Heidi and a few others who got that. The original collective colonial noun for a herd of elephants is a parade. A parade of elephants. And the reason that made me think of that is as they were marching down the road, it did look almost military-like, like they were on parade. Now, if any of you have watched the original Jungle Book movie, that sort of military inspired theme with those ellies was probably quite a lot to do with that original collective noun. There we go, Astralina. Spot on, the elephant marching song from the Jungle Book. So that parade. Fortunately, it looks like these guys are going to go, or maybe not. Let's just try and jump up ahead to the front of the herd, and then we're just going to sit and wait and let them come to us. It's always better to let elephants come into your space rather than putting yourself in theirs. Why that elephant was browsing on the marula instead of eating nice fresh grass. So if we actually, while we wait for the ellies, they're going to come out in front of us here. If you actually have a look in this particular area we are, there's actually not that much grass, and a lot of what looks like grass is little perennial weeds or wild flowers. So there's not too much grass here. Now where there is lots of nice grass, they will feed, but they will also browse. So when there is grass around, about 80% of their diet will consist of grass during the summer months, about 20% browse. And that inverts during the winter months, only 20% browsing. I mean, 20% grazing and 80% browse. There we go. Now, this nice fresh grass isn't so fresh anymore. Some of it will be getting quite dry already. And as I said, as much of a welcome respite that that rain was for a lot of the animals, that rain came right at the end of the growth season. So a lot of the plants and grasses haven't had a lot of time to grow. So it's going to be a long dry season still. Here comes a little one just behind this female. Hello, little man. His little boy. It looks like he had a wet. So these family units of elephants are pretty much in control, are controlled by a dominant female who's the matriarch. Now, Corinne, who's in Minnesota, is wondering, well, does she decide who gets to leave, who gets to stay? To a degree, yes. You will find generally that these little family units are made up of a few related females. with the oldest female generally not always being the matriarch. And the only individuals who are really forced to leave are going to be the young bulls as soon as they get to that sort of troublesome age. And with certain bulls, that can be as young as 14 or 15, but generally a bit closer to 20. But even once they have been evicted from the breeding herds, they do trail them. They're not quite ready to leave mom, but they cause too many problems. And at that age, they've got so many hormones flowing around that they tend to just be a little bit overexcitable. So she definitely knows where she's going, and she's not really stopping and feeding. And she seems to be leading the herd there, that large female who was being followed by the little one initially. Unfortunately, it seems like they are heading a little bit further to the sort of northeast, away from our eastern boundary and into Torchwood. So we're going to move on and see what else we can find. I've been asked a few times about this very cool caterpillar we found a few days ago, and it is the instar larval stage of the African vagrant, which is a butterfly we see quite commonly, and it's been feeding off its favorite host plant, which is the senna. Now here we go, you can have a look. And I'm going to see if we can find any of those caterpillars. We also got asked if we could try to check if they got a cocoon. And if they do cocoon, maybe we can actually keep one and see what's going on. But you can see how these centers have been completely stripped. I mean, there's almost not a leaf left here. And that is all from the African vagrant butterfly. Now, I'm just trying to see if I can find a cocoon or even a live caterpillar. It seems like they didn't get all the way to this one, as the flowers are still intact and doesn't look like it's been fed on too much. But I mean, underneath here, you can just see there's lots and lots of little caterpillar poops. So, but no sign of the larva yet. So there's another spot I want to check. Hello, hello.
Hello.
Hi, Umvo. So Andrew from Cheetah Plains is coming past us.
Yes.
How's everyone doing?
Hello, very well.
Very good. With animals?
Yeah.
I know you're hiding them.
I know. Say animal come out when they want.
I know. Well, good luck.
Right.
We'll see you later.
All right,
no, they should come out right there soon.
Which one, sir?
The Dove.
Oh, it's in Dove. Yeah, that's, they went
more coming.
That yeah. way. There's more.
There's more.
Okay.
With babies.
Oh, very nice. Well, we might have a gander down there. Good luck.
Thanks
so much. There we go. So a lot of you out there have to attend meetings and whatnot, you know, for work. There's my afternoon business meeting, finding out where the Ndlovu, where the elephant are wandering. Okay, we're just going to check slightly up ahead for those beautiful little vagrant caterpillars. I think this was the spot. They've literally completely depleted a whole field of senna. Now, the thing that amazed me the most about, wow, there's even less leaves left than when I was last year. That amazed me the most about this particular little caterpillar. So he's not one of the noxious ones, so not like an Acria or monarch that eats plants to sequester poison for their adulthood. But as, in his caterpillar stage, he's got three different forms of defense. And if we can find one of those caterpillars, I'm hoping we are able to. Be careful, there's some elephants on the way. Now, could we be too late? Have I come to check a day or two too late that there are no more caterpillars left? Well, that looks to be the case, I'm afraid. Now, I couldn't find where they actually go once they start, going into a cocoon. So for those of you who missed, I know a few of you would have seen those caterpillars on the safari with us a few times as we came to check their progress of how they decimated the centers of cheetah cutline. But I will find you. Well, let's move on. I will find you what they look like shortly. And we will try to find you an adult African vagrant so you can have a look at it. The butterfly. There we go. So there he is. That's what we were looking for on the centers. And there we go. You can see there's the exact little plant we were looking at that it's been eaten. It used to be called a cassia. It's now changed. And there's the adult butterfly with its wings closed and with its wings open. So there we go, there the wings open. Apparently you have seen them earlier with Jamie. There's very distinct little two black spots on the inside of the wing. Now the caterpillar itself, as I said, it had three different defense mechanisms. And if we have a look carefully there, it actually felt like sandpaper. It had a very rough edge to it. The other thing is, which I haven't seen too many caterpillar species do, is it leaps. So as you touch it, it jumps and then goes dead still. So it sort of tries to get out of whatever might be eating its sort of space and then just keeps dead still. So quite a useful tactic. So the one leapt quite far from us. I think it leapt about 30 centimeters. So you imagine a bird might get slightly confused by that. And then the third, which is quite a common one with most insect species, is that they vomit up something disgusting. Generally bile, so quite bitter tasting to try dissuade predators from eating them. But it looks like we were too late. And unfortunately, in my research, I haven't been able to find out exactly where those caterpillars go where the pupa stage is. Okay, so while we continue on to explore the far eastern reaches of Juma Private Game Reserve, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
I am exploring and waiting to see if we can have an opportunity to head in and have a look at those Guma lionesses. I'm still trying to find this buffalo herd that they were following. You'd think that a group of 100, 200 animals would leave behind some evidence. Admittedly, however, I have taken a long way round to where I think they might be, just to double check that the lionesses haven't come through. I've spoken to the guides on Arethusa. All five of them are in exactly the same place that we left them. And in an interesting turn of affairs, James has now started calling me pajamas on the Game Drive channel. That's interesting. I'm not sure where that came from. I'm pretty sure he met me. I assume that was me he was referring to. No, I'm still pajamas. Standing by James. James, it seems as though Karula's crossed south. Mike Cheetah Plains has picked up on Nkonzo 4, Madodo Ngala on Gowrie Main, Mobile East around the Muwati that he says are fairly fresh. Not sure if you want to contact him. Sorry, I'm chuckling just at James's nickname. Oh, goodness, we found ourselves an elephants have done some landscaping. That's relatively fresh. A large marula tree that has been pushed over by an elephant. It's always extraordinary to just imagine the power of an elephant that did that. And that was, that might not even have been a bull. That could easily have been a cow, a female elephant, just pushing against it. And admittedly, the marula tree is not the hardest wood. In fact, it's a very, very soft wood when compared to something like a bush willow or a leadwood, for example. Even so, that is no mean feat to simply snap something over like that. And I always find that a tremendous lesson in the power of those animals when you see something like that stretched out across a road. They are truly extraordinary animals. I've just had a report from Mike at Cheetah Plains. He says that he has male lion tracks going east on Gowrie Main. Apparently, those caterpillars that you might have seen with Brent launching themselves out of the way. Brian, I think you were filming that.
Yeah.
The incredible jumping caterpillars. Let's go this way. Oops, sorry, everybody, changing direction. We're going this way now. And Debbie was wondering, since he was continuing that search and struggling to find any, he was saying with so many butterflies about and yet no caterpillars, do they really pupate that fast? It's a very good point. And I mean, most butterflies, the sort of the time period during which they are in their cocoons pupating would be, what is it? It's a couple of weeks, depending on the species. Probably between 2 to 4 weeks, with the occasional butterfly pupating within one. I'm not sure why it is that he's struggling to find them. I don't know if it's just because they come in sort of in population bursts. Obviously, it has to happen or occur where the female lays her eggs. So it might be that Brent is not looking in the right place, but 100 meters away in a different bush on a different senna, there's 1,000 caterpillars that have recently hatched and are in the process of eating, consuming enough to begin that process of the metamorphosis in their cocoons. Now, I don't know if it's a combination of the fact that maybe they do have quite a rapid life cycle, combined with the fact that they aren't necessarily going to be on every senna, but where they are on a plant, there's lots of them in one go, if that makes sense. So lots at one time. I'm not sure, Debbie. This is sort of the first time, I think it was the first time that Brent's not necessarily seen the caterpillars of the African vagrant, but certainly managed to put them on camera. I'll keep looking as well, because there are lots and lots of senna plants in this area as well. What I found fascinating is where I used to work, which was not all that far away from here, the area that I was in before I started at Wild Earth, we used to see processionary caterpillars absolutely everywhere. Those caterpillars that move nose to tail of the next set across the road and onto the next bush, and they do that so that essentially they look like one, like a twig lying in the road. They don't look like individual caterpillars. Very, very hairy caterpillars, and when they do pupate, they give rise to a moth known as a processionary moth. Now, processionary moths, where I used to work, were an absolute, I wouldn't call them a nightmare, but let's just say that you never, ever, ever left your clothes on the washing line overnight. And that is because they had this scaly-like substance, or almost powder-like substance, on their wings, that if they left that residue on your clothes, you would not, and you put those clothes on, you would not stop scratching for days at a time. I'm gonna find this oriole for you. I can hear him calling. And I'll find you a picture of a processionary moth. what they look like while you just find this Oriole. Oh, our job has become so much more difficult since it rained. Everything has so many more places to hide away. I think he's a little bit too far into the bush to be able to see. Right, do you think I can multitask in order to look up the moth and drive at the same time? I'm sure we can. Let's give it a go. Oh, goodness, I hope it's in this book. Oopsie. Maybe this isn't my brightest and best idea. Maybe I should just stop the car. I feel as though we could go careering into a tree, and I'm sure I'd never hear the end of it. Brent would probably offer to teach me to drive again. There are so many different moth species that we might have a little bit of difficulty. Look at how the sun is coming out. Okay, well, we've managed to find moths. It might be that we won't have a picture in this particular book. I know that Brent has got the butterfly book. Unfortunately it might... Oh, there we go. I did find them. So this is the caterpillar that I was talking about. Let me turn Brent and James's conversation down. So this is what I mean when I said that they walk basically face to bum as they walk along. So they're right next to the different individuals, and it makes them look indistinguishable. One is indistinguishable from the other. But when you see that with a hairy caterpillar, you immediately know that this is not a caterpillar that you want to go touching with your bare hands or in any way allowing into contact with your skin. That's what the adult form looks like. And if you look really hard, you can sort of see the fluffiness to them on this particular adult. Terribly, terribly itchy. It's something that sends you into a rash. Apparently, people have made errors before in attempting to use the cocoons of the processionary moth caterpillars to turn them into silk. Terribly bad idea, because within those cocoons, all of those little hairs around those caterpillars have embedded themselves. So you essentially end up making silk that is completely unusable unless you wish to sell it to somebody who would prefer to be itchy for the rest of their lives. Now there's a theory. I mean, I was trying to get you that Oriole on camera. Now an Oriole, one of their main dietary requirements is hairy caterpillars. They are adapted to eat hairy caterpillars. There was a theory that went around ornithologists a couple of years back that the reasons why cuckoos have evolved as brood parasites is because their primary diet is hairy caterpillars, which the offspring would not be able to cope with, being fed on those hairy caterpillars. That is a theory that I encountered and immediately questioned, and since proved to be totally incorrect, because of course the black-headed oriole, that bird that was whistling off in the distance, is also a predominantly hairy caterpillar feeder, and yet has absolutely no problem in feeding and looking after its own offspring. So it will continue to be a mystery as to why cuckoos are actually brood parasites. course, with that brute parasitism comes a wide variety of different methods that the host bird species will employ in order to avoid being parasitized by the host, because that's the last thing that they want to invest their energy in. Gracie, who is one of our 8-year-old viewers. Hi, Gracie. Gracie, you wanted to know whether or not we could watch a caterpillar turn into a butterfly. And unfortunately for us, Gracie, it would take us a very long time to be able to watch that. But there are lots and lots of videos of people who have sped up the time. So they've put a camera in place looking at where a caterpillar starts to build its cocoon, starts to spin its cocoon, and they put a camera there and they videotape the whole process. They filmed the whole process of the caterpillar turning into a butterfly. And I'm sure that you would be able to find one of those, or maybe your mom or one of your nurses could help you find one of those videos. Now, it's something that I look out for in particular. Gracie, if I ever see a caterpillar that's busy weaving its cocoon, what I'll do is I promise I'll set up a camera for you and then I'll show you the sped up video. But we'll have to wait a little bit because it's going to take them a couple of weeks to do that big change from, because it's a big change. They have to go from a caterpillar with lots and lots of legs and change themselves into an animal with wings. They have to make those wings inside their cocoon, so it does take them a little bit of time. And I am actually going to stop for this because it takes us back to Lucy's question on the mockingbirds and the imitators. Now, where is he gone? Here he is. The fork-tailed drongo, the greatest mimic in the skies out here. Oh, where are we looking? He's a little bit that side. Sorry, Brian. And he's managed to catch something. And funnily enough, I was watching out of the corner of my eye. I actually think he stole that catch from another bird, a smaller bird. It looked like it might have been a canary or something like that. And I spoke about Lucy's question and the fact that these fork-tailed drongos are exceptionally widely spread throughout South Africa, even in the arid desert areas with meerkats. Just bear with me for 1 second, sorry. Brent is trying to get hold of me on the Gay Drive channel. Standing by, Brent. Brent, I'm slowly working my way towards the Nkomazon Arethusa, unless you would like to go. Copy. Oh, there he goes. Looking to catch something in the grass. But yes, back to the meerkat story. Meerkats have lots and lots of different alarm calls. Some of them mean look up to the skies, there's an eagle. Some of them mean band together, there is a snake. It provokes lots of different responses. That was also, by the way, incredible camera work on Brian's behalf. And the drongos in that area have learnt the alarm call of meerkats that means drop whatever you're doing and dash to the burrow. And they wait until the meerkats have gathered a particularly juicy snack, at which point they give that alarm call and then rush down and steal. Oh, that's awesome, Brian. Steal whatever snack the meerkats happen to leave behind. Utilizing that perch is a great place to stop and look about. Okay, let's leave our fork-tailed drongo. Well done, Brian. And let's slowly start making our way towards those lions on Arethusa. As I said, I'm not in any real rush. I've got the updates from the Arethusa guides that there's quite a few people still waiting for a chance to see them. And at the moment, they haven't moved very far from where we left them this morning. But they're still quite happily lying down. But as things get cooler, of course, that could well change. And those are my plans for the afternoon. Let's find out what Brent has planned for the rest of his.
So, as Jean-André and I have been perusing the eastern sectors, and I've been checking for tracks of that male leopard called Gejima, unfortunately it seems like he's possibly still to the north or to the east. I have heard a report that there were tracks of Birmingham males and possibly Styx lioness quite close to the cheetah cut line, but unfortunately they are still to the east. So we're just going to slowly check back towards there. I know Aubrey's gone in to have a look, check up on those tracks. So as soon as I get an update, I'll let you know. Hopefully, fingers crossed, those Birmingham boys decide to meander north towards us. But it is a spectacularly beautiful evening. The temperature's dropping quite quickly, and I think we're going to be in for some chilly mornings shortly. As we get into the dry months, all this green will disappear and it's going to become quite barren. And Susan in Long Island is wondering if there's a fire. Does everyone in the area help, or is there a fire station nearby? No fire station. Each of the individual lodges will have quickly across to Jamie.
Look at these guys go. I know it's not the best view you've ever seen, but the kudu are racing around, having such an incredible game. I really hope it continues. They keep dashing up. Oh, they're gonna come back around the Turmark Mound. Let me go forward a little bit so you can see. I've never seen them. Oh, no, they're coming back this way. I've never seen them play like this. I've seen Inyala do it, but I've never seen little kudu do it. They're having a wonderful time. Oh dear, I go forward. They're gonna come back. Oh, this is so difficult. There's a head sticking up at the top. Let's just go forward a little bit. What are you doing, you little things? Are you having such a good game on your termite mound? Whee! Showing off their newly found agility. Isn't that beautiful? All stopped to look at us intently. Incredible. I mean, these kudu were only born a couple of months ago and they're dashing about on those spindly little legs that barely look strong enough to hold them. Here comes the last one. Oh, up onto the termite mound. And racing back down again. Whoop! Change my mind. Now, initially, when we first saw them, they were running circles around us, like the Nyala were doing a couple of months ago in that one sighting. Oh, now we're playing King of the Castle on the termite mound. This is incredible to witness. I love it when antelope play. It just gives you a whole different level of insight into their personalities. And the adults looking on, there's an adult female at the back on the right, keeping a close eye on us. And regarding the antics of the youngsters with dignity and tolerance. Oopsie. Some of them look as though they're about to fall down. Every now and again, careful. Last thing you want is a broken ankle. Well, we're all going to cluster on the top of this termite mound now. There's about 6 youngsters here. All dashing about. This is so lovely to see. These are definitely high up on my list of favorite antelope species. Musical, you were wondering while we watched these kudu play about just how many antelope species are indigenous to South Africa. And I'm going to give you an answer in one moment. I don't know the exact number. I have to think about it because Southern Africa and South Africa are two very different things. And I can only really give you the answer in Southern Africa. It should be quite similar to the answer for South Africa. Look at it go with its tail in the air. Having such a ball. While we watch them, musical, I'm going to start listing antelope that occur in South Africa, and this is not just in this area. So there is the black wildebeest, the blue wildebeest, the Liechtenstein hartebeest, a red hartebeest, so we're on 4 now, Bontebok makes 5, Blesbok makes 6, Tsessebe makes 7, red dacre, common dacre, and the blue dacre make 10, springbok 11, klipspringer 12, damara dikdik, which is not something that occurs in South Africa but does occur in Southern Africa, makes 11. The orubi is 12, steenbok 13, cape grysbok and sharp grysbok 15. The little suni is 16, similar to a steenbok in size and shape. Impala are 17. A roan and a sable makes 19. The gemsbok makes 20. The waterbucks makes 21. And then the bushbuck, nyala, kudu, elant. I've lost track now. I got distracted by James's voice on the Game Drive channel, so I hope you were all keeping track of them. It said elant. The southern reedbuck, the southern mountain reedbuck, while we watch these kudu dash about. The grey reebuck, the red lechwe, the puku, the sitatunga. Whew. And that was a list of all of the antelope species that I can think of within Southern Africa. I really hope you were keeping count because I couldn't really listen to James watch the kudu and list all the antelope at the same time. So I hope you were keeping count, musical. That was a list of all of them. And now, our little kudu, sedately wandering off. Excess energy has been utilized. They're calm again. And off they go. First time I've seen kudu calves playing like that since I started working at Wild Earth. So a very special sighting in this incredible afternoon light. The reason my train of thought derailed completely, because I heard James's report about the buffalo herd that he's finally found on Philemon's cutline, or that has finally been found. Before I leave, and I mentioned about that I was giving you a count for Southern Africa and not South Africa itself. And Chantel, in the UK, you were wondering what the difference is. The Southern Africa region, South Africa being the country, Southern Africa including South Africa, Swaziland, Lesotho, Namibia, Botswana, Zimbabwe, and a little bit of Mozambique as well. So that southern section of Africa, and then that includes South Africa, the country. So that's what I was referring to as, and the reason why I didn't make an exact distinction between South Africa and Southern Africa, I didn't count just the antelope in South Africa, is because there are certain areas where they've been introduced, there are certain places where those ranges just overlap, and we get to experience magical sightings like the one we've just had with the kudu. Right, back over to Brent, let's see what he's up to.
What was that? Fascinating. Some kudu having a silly 5 minutes. And we were chatting about fires and how we deal with them out here. So each individual lodge will have a sort of a firefighting kit with a water bowser and some beaters. But I don't think we're going to have to worry too much about fires this year. This is not going to be much grass to burn due to the lack of rain. So we are checked the east extensively. We are now heading back down towards the south, and I think we might go see if there's a chance that there's been any leopard movement along that southern boundary again. So Tingana and Tundi crossed out there this morning, not to say they couldn't cross back, you never know, and especially now that it's a little bit cooler, I'm going to go have a look. Also, I'm just going to pop across to the Eastern Channel quickly, see if I can get an update on Karuda for you guys, because the last tracks I had were heading back across. Afternoon stations in the east. Is anyone copying me? Very quiet over the radio. Okay, maybe they're all in the west. Now, these seasonal pans are absolutely spectacular, especially these ones on the sort of floodplain of a little river like the Mwati. So as you can see, hives of activity. Now, lots of little creatures. Oh, there's one little creature there, John. They just come out a little bit. I think it's, okay, slightly to the right. Zoom. A bird. Zoom. A little bit to the right. There he is. And that is a bird we have not seen in a long time. An exquisite little bird called a malachite kingfisher. Now, he will eat little fish, but he'll also eat lots of tadpoles and other creatures. Now, this is the smallest kingfisher species we get here, and one of the only pescivorians, so one of the true fish eaters, and is associated with water. So woodlands and brown hooded and striped, they feed more of insects and away from water. But the little tiny little guys, a malachite kingfisher, very pretty. I know he's a bit far, unfortunately he's just on the other side of the boundary at that little seasonal pan, but there we go, that's what he looks like up close. And we haven't seen them too much this year because of the lack of rain. I think this might even be my first one on live drives this year, and hopefully a new one for the bird lists, for those of you who've just started. As I was just saying, these little pans like we're looking at here are absolutely exquisite, especially here on the floodplain. Now, I'm going to ask Jean-Ray to pan, show you why we're on a floodplain. So, if we start just over there, sorry, Jean-Ray, and we start there, you see, now that is your sort of line of your 100-year flood. So, there it starts going up. But now, if we come back across and come a bit wider, you can see it's quite sandy here. And the tree species that are here, you've got these nice leadwood trees. So all this topsoil that has been dumped by big floods in the past has been put here. So you quite often get some nice big trees, and you get quite a few different species of trees that aren't too common elsewhere in the reserve. And along with that, you get these beautiful pans. So, hello, Zoe, 68. Zoe says, do we occasionally get thunderstorms in winter? It is possible. It is very.
Just look at the sky. Brian and I were just discussing the weather and what sort of evening we're going to experience. We've both come to the conclusion with these cirrus clouds, or almost cirrus clouds, not quite high enough, but there are definitely some in the sky there, that we're going to be experiencing chilly temperatures this evening. I'm very, very glad, first of all, that I wore a long-sleeved shirt, and secondly, that I brought a jacket with me this afternoon, because it is going to be, I think it's going to be chilly. I'm quite enjoying this autumnal weather in its own way. It's sort of, it's got that transition feeling. It's a bit strange. It's almost unsettling, but not quite. And it's very, very beautiful. It's making for the most extraordinary sunsets that we're experiencing. Come to me just at the moment where I was about to jump onto the Game Drive comms to the Arethusa guide, so bear with me for 1 second. As we head on to Zebra Drive. Oh. Afternoon stations, what's the lineup for those in Gala?
Sorry about that. It seems like we had some gremlins there, and now I've completely forgotten what I was talking about. John, do you remember?
Thunderstorms.
Thunderstorms in winter. There we go. And it was from Chloe, if I remember correctly. So, or Zoe. Zoe 68. There we go. So we do almost always get rain during winter, but it's not normally a thunderstorm. Our thunderstorms are generally in the summer months. But as Ernest Hemingway said, two things one should never predict: the weather and a woman's moods. So we're going to head out of this area we've been working now. I think I might meander towards the northwest, have a look around Sydney's waterhole, see if there's anything happening in those parts, because it is very, very quiet where we've been. Deborah, the armchair traveller, said, did I say that malachite kingfisher was the smallest or one of the smallest? I think it is slightly bigger than the pygmy, but it is one of the smallest. There are a couple of species that you get up in Central Africa that are smaller than both of those. It would be the African dwarf kingfisher, if I remember correctly. Let me just double check for you, Deborah. I'm pretty sure pygmy, so 14 centimeters for malachite. And 13 centimeters for a pygmy. So one of the smallest. Now the pygmies are migratory, they've already left. We had quite a few of them around, and I know a lot of you remember some fantastic sightings of pygmy kingfisher at one of the hyena dens. Oh, kind of a spider web. Sorry. Here we go. See, we're heading west into the setting sun. Just checking for tracks here. Well, it's my pleasure. Mike in Florida, who's one of our avid birders, says, thanks, Brent. Kingfishers are my favorite. Yes, well, unfortunately, we haven't been seeing too many kingfishers with this dry weather, and maybe next year we'll get a few more. Now, there's a few kingfisher species that can possibly occur here. And we have seen, I think, a majority of them this year. Wow, Marilyn in Montana. A new bird species for her on her live bird list, number 151, with pictures. Well, keep it up, Marilyn. Mike, you better watch out. You got some competition. In the gap there on the termite mound under the tree. You got him. There we go. Here we go. That's some little dwarf mongoose peering at us from their castle. Now they live in disused termite mounds. Hey, little chaps. Now they'll be probably going to be sleeping in this particular termite mound. Oh, there we go, look at that, see, grooming each other. An incredibly social little animal. Now, and they're very, very cute. It's the smallest member of the order Carnivora in Africa. And have a very interesting social structure. Now, very, very tight-knit little community with lots of grooming, as you can see. This grooming normally takes place now as they come home for the evening, so to speak, or when they wake up in the morning, and they're late risers. So they like to bask in the sun outside their termite mound before heading out to forage. Now, they have a very similar social structure to the African wild dog, strangely enough. So they have an alpha pair, and only the alpha pair breeds. Now, the most fascinating thing for me is, unlike most animals, I'm just going to try to slide, I think, a little bit forward, which is better, Jandre. Oh, heads down. They should pop up again. Let's just see if we can get a better view of them. There we go, through there somewhere. And you'll hear me make some little noises. Oh, he's popping up to the right there. Unfortunately, just behind the leaves. Well spotted, Jandre. Definitely not our most clear dwarf mongoose sighting. Let's try a little bit more forward. But as I was saying, that they have a very similar social structure to the African wild dog. But one of the major... There we go. That's what we were looking for. One of the major differences between them and most other social predators is how they sort out hierarchy. So if one of the alpha pair dies, what will happen is... Oh, very cute. Has he got a tick on him? Or is that just a... Hey, he's got a white spot. Maybe an old injury. So what they do is they actually have a groom off. So if they're two members of the business that are of a similar rank, they will literally love each other. And the person who loves the most wins. So they're literally covered in saliva. It looks like they've actually been dropped into a bucket of water. They're so wet. And those two individuals will keep licking and licking and licking each other. And the mongoose that's the most loving becomes the next dominant in the social hierarchy, which is absolutely fascinating. Because most animals in the wild choose to fight and use aggression. Dwarf mongoose use cuddles. And we'll leave them to their social grooming and getting ready for bed while we continue west towards the setting sun. Now, Marilyn is wondering, what is the most numerous animal on Juma? And that is quite an easy one to answer. It is the impala. It's actually the most numerous antelope south of the Sahara. One of the most successful species in Africa, and they are able to inhabit a wide variety of habitats, and that's what makes them so successful. Now, they are generalists, so they're not specialists like a wildebeest or a zebra who will only eat grass. Impala are generalists, so they will feed off both leaves and grass, which obviously enables them to inhabit quite different areas from a lot of the other species. They also have such a successful design. There are fossil records of impala from 1.6 million years ago that are exactly the same as today. So very successful in their breeding and in their adaptation to inhabit as many different types of habitat as possible. The only places you're not going to find impala south of the Sahara, where they haven't been removed by people, but I mean naturally, is the densest of the rainforests and also the driest of the deserts. Other than that, impala are pretty well spread through arid areas, wet areas, and a really fascinating species. It's quite often overlooked on safari, just because there are so many of them. Now, Zoe68, hello again. Zoe would like to know, do you ever see people with mongooses pets? You do. It's not ideal, and we had mongoose as pets as we were kids. They were rehab things that were given by the Natal Parks Board, which is the sort of big the people who look after all the game reserves in KwaZulu-Natal. Now, they are really fun and they are very loving, and you can imagine a very social animal with a very complex social system. You immediately become part of their business. For those who are not sure why I'm saying a business, just let you know that's the original or correct collective noun for mongoose. It's a business of mongoose. So the biggest problem is you now become their business, literally. Specifically if you've got males and females, so their territory is marked extensively with anal pastings, and any new person who walks into your house, the mongoose doesn't know, he will immediately anal paste on their feet. Zandre is giving me this wide-eyed, I've seen a track look, so we're going to have a quick squiz. Now, what track is it, John? It's a male leopard, I'm thinking. And the female's the side. I think it's Tandi and Tingana. This is where they went south. Unfortunately, John has now has got a sad face that these leopard tracks have departed. So, well spotted there. We get kudos for spotting the leopard tracks. So saying why mongoose are not the greatest pets. Now also, if that person reacts negatively, which a lot of people who are not used to the bush do when they get anal pasted on by a mongoose, they tend to jump up and down and scream, which makes the mongoose a little bit angry, and they have incredibly sharp teeth. And then mongoose bites, said the screaming visitor after being anal pasted on. So we had we had banded mongoose as pets, and the one was called Lord Montague because he was literally the lord of the house. And also quite difficult because he was a male. He immediately thought my dad was a problem because mom was the dominant female, and he used to give my dad an incredibly hard time, biting his big toes. He took his boots off, stealing his socks. I think the one day Monty got into very big trouble. He went and hid under my bed for a very long time. He managed to grab my dad's steak off his plate as he had just sat down to eat. He did some quite serious maneuvering to get to the steak, and as my dad sort of looked away, gone, end of snake. So we've had a lot of wild pets while I was growing up, and unfortunately there's never really a nice story that ends with the wild pets, because they are wild animals. And Lord Montague, he got eaten by a martial eagle. We had two impala. One was called Biltong, the other was called Pot Roast. They both got killed by the cheetah. I think one of the only ones that successfully made it back into the wild was Hamish the Diker. But generally not a good idea to keep wild pets if you can avoid it, as it there's a reason they haven't been domesticated, and it's better to leave them out in the wild. So I know that sounds quite difficult. I mean, you can imagine finding a tiny baby mongoose that's been abandoned, and you want to pick it up and take it home, but it's actually better to let whatever's going to eat it, rather than get involved. Yes, and I've just been reminded, we did have another one. We had Genevieve the Genet, who used to live in the sock drawer and was the most cleanly pet we've ever had. She would only go to the loo over in the basin, exactly over the plug holes. That was Genevieve. Now, there's another problem having a nocturnal pet. As well as you go to bed, Genevieve thinks it's playtime, and having a Genet, who's fortunately not that big, leap onto your head at 3 a.m. is somewhat disturbing to some people. But generally, we try to leave the animals out in the bush where they belong. About and looking at the smallest member of the carnivore family, Jamie has got the largest.
Here we go, across to Africa's biggest predator, the beautiful pride of Nkuhuma lionesses. And you can actually, from this angle, far better than we could see this morning, you can see that they are very, very hungry. Look at the way the hips are sticking out on that one female. She definitely looks as though she is in need of a good meal. And that could well be the sub-adult. The sub-adult in this group always looks a little bit hungrier than the rest of them. Where we left them this morning. This morning they were even more impossibly hidden from the monkey orange thicket around them. Now they've moved out slightly more into the open. Four of them there, and on the left, with her belly up in the air, the fifth lioness. Exposing the white belly to the cool evening air, and the five of them preparing for the moment when they will head off and hunt. The reason why I got so distracted listening to James's update about that buffalo herd and where they were located was because I think that in the next few hours that will be the plan of the Nkuhumas. Whether or not it remains to be seen whether or not they decide to follow those buffalo. Quick clean and a quick scratch. It's a very lazy. There we go. She's looking. You can actually see her physically looking for the itchy spot before she started scratching. Heads up. Not fully on alert, but definitely looks as though there's a hint of interest in her eyes. Well, one of the vehicles has moved out of the sighting, so we will be able to reposition and get a slightly clearer view. I just want to see what this lioness decides to do. Let's see if she... I think she's going to flop back down. Now, a couple of big yawns. Oh, look at those ferocious teeth. Now, a couple of big yawns, restlessness like scratching, licking their paws. Very often suggest that they are about to get up and move. And Kat in Tampa, you're saying, have these lionesses moved at all since the morning safari? Time to get up and hunt, ladies. And I think that is what they plan to do. That one female already showing signs of restlessness. Kat, they have moved. They've actually moved further west than their position earlier, so further into Arethusa rather than further east towards Juma, which isn't what I really expected them to do. But I think we can expect in the next few minutes that they are going to get up and start moving across the boundary line. We shall have to wait and see. She's licking again. And as I said, those signs of restlessness can sometimes precede a movement. In that case, it was just in response to a fly. But we'll have to start seeing it from more than one female before we can say that the pride itself is going to get up and move further and go hunting. And you'll probably find that they will wait for darkness before they actually go hunting properly. But they could get moving before then. We've got probably another few minutes of them sleeping, and then it remains to be seen. Let's go forward a little bit. There's another vehicle coming to join us, and we need to make space for them. Plus, it gives us a slightly different view. Interesting how this particular pride, when they're all together, all five of them together, they are perfectly relaxed with this kind of space between us and them. Yet when there's only two of them, that instantly changes and they become a little bit more skittish around the presence of vehicles. And that, I think, is just, it's one of the reasons why it's so important for us to really study their body language and their behavior. And while I was pulling forward there, I was watching them the whole time, just to make sure that they weren't in any way unsettled by our approach. As you can see, they're quite happy with us being next to them. This is definitely an improvement on the view that we had this morning. Thank you, ladies. Pile of very flat lions. That is the sub-adult at the back that I mentioned. She always looks slightly thinner than the others. That's for a couple of reasons. One, she's still a late sort of teenager, so all that growing, that lanky growing that teenagers do. And then she's also smaller than the others. And of course, with lion prides, there's no altruism in the way that they feed. It is every lion for his or herself when it comes to a kill, and as such, the sub-adult can't quite compete with the rest of the adults in terms of physical strength. What a beautiful picture these lionesses make in this afternoon light. I'm not sure which one Amber Eyes is. I can safely say it's not the lioness in the front. Amber Eyes, of course, being probably the most distinctive of this lion pride. She's got very orangey coloured eyes as opposed to the normal yellow of most lionesses. When you see them sleeping like this, it's so hard to picture them as the fierce and efficient killers that they are. They look so incredibly peaceful that it's so easy to imagine them as similar to domestic cats. That, of course, is not the case. And those paws that look so soft and gentle are actually of tremendous strength. Those forearms, powerfully muscled, and of course the dagger-like claws that are nestled within their sheaths, ready to be extended at the slightest provocation. They truly are magnificent animals. And I always feel that the Nkuhumas are some of the most beautiful lions I've ever seen. There's a leanness and I think I would almost describe them as svelte. And they always, even when they're a little bit thin, look in good condition. And it's so nice to see them looking like this after the tumultuous events of the last few months and the things that they've experienced. Losing three of their members, four if we count Junior. Ooh, she's dreaming, look. That's not a fly response. That's a dream. I wonder what she's dreaming of. Chasing buffalo? Chasing zebra and impala? Maybe she's dreaming of having a meal all to herself without having to share it with the rest of the pride for once. Maybe she's dreaming of chasing after a handsome Birmingham boy. Either way, she is most definitely dreaming. That's not a fly response. Look at that. Where are you running in your sleep, girl? Even the back foot's twitching now. That's lovely. We so often get asked about whether or not animals dream, especially lions, since we do spend a fair amount of time with sleepy lions. And this is such a good proof that they really do. Just like your domestic cats or your pet cats and dogs at home twitch when they sleep. And a big sigh from one of them. All of them starting to shift around. Oh, look at that big stretch in her sleep. In the process, kicking the female in front of her. Lions naturally do not have severe personal space boundaries. And Donna's mentioned that it's so lovely to see them sleeping so close together. It is, isn't it? It helps that it's not a hot day, so they're not going to overheat each other. Although I've never seen that stop them before. Very often lie close together, even despite the heat. But it just emphasizes, and it has an important biological function. It emphasizes the closeness of the bonds between the members of this pride, or between any pride. They're all related to each other, whether it be a female and her daughters, or two sisters, or an aunt, or a cousin. They're connected by genetics and by shared experiences, and that bond is what makes lions so successful and makes them the apex predator of this area, especially at night. Not, of course, counting human beings. And that incredible tight bond will be evidenced a little bit later tonight when they set off hunting. I'm not sure why we've got Lona over there at the back. Maybe she's had a slight tiff with the lionesses, or maybe she just got tired of being kicked in the kidneys. There you go, Vic. There's the fifth lioness. She, for some reason, has decided that this afternoon she would like some space. Thank you very much. She could well have been lying with them. It might also have been that there was a patch of shade there earlier that was only big enough for four, and she had to go off and find her own. Or maybe, as I said, she just got a little bit tired of being trodden on or sat on. The sub-adult in particular, I've noticed, with the Nkuhumas, is very affectionate, but she doesn't always necessarily recognize when she's crossed a personal space boundary. You know, she'll walk up to one of the females, give her a head rub, which is all fine and well, and then sits on one of their heads. As I pulled in here, I told you exactly how I was interpreting the lion's body language and their behavior. And Zoe was wondering if you get any training on reading it. And Zoe, yes, you do. You do get training, and a lot of the textbooks will provide you with the basics. However, nothing can really, in its own way, match up for the time that you spend with the animals. So there's a combination of what you learn as you go along, and then there's also instinct. And you can learn, it's something, it's that observational skill is something that you can learn just by watching your pets at home, because a lot of the visual cues are very, very similar. So yes, it is something that you absolutely can be trained in, and then something that you work at perfecting over time, and you get better at it. And you slowly build up a dictionary of a lioness's vocabulary or an elephant's vocabulary. And by reading the signs that they give each other, you can interpret the signs that they show you. Because at the end of the day, it's so important for a lot of different reasons. One, we're in their home. We're in their home, and they don't speak our language. It's imperative that we learn to speak theirs so that we do not adversely affect them in any way. And that's a very important part. Oh. Invasion of personal space there. Foot to chin. This is... She's about to get kicked. There's some cuts on the inside of this lioness's leg, on the inside of her back leg there. And then along her side, there's a healing injury. Something that obviously occurred quite a while ago. We saw it. We have seen that before. You can see it's picked up a little bit of the dirt. But something that's being fixed up nicely. That could have come from a couple of things, but most likely it was an injury obtained in hunting. Sorry guys, bear with me 1 second. Game Drive channel, just need to use it for a second. Continuing their conversation, I'll wait for my moment to be able to say something. Oh, there's an animal I haven't seen in a while. Well, I take the opportunity to chat a little bit on the Game Drive comms and communicate some stuff. Let's go over to Brent, who has the tallest creature out here.
Well, here we go, and I just said this morning I hadn't seen a giraffe in an age, and there we go. Lots of giraffes. There's actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 around us at the moment, feeding on the acacias. Acacia exuvialis, to be precise, the flaky thorn acacia. They must have meandered in during the day. I know a firm favorite of a lot of our viewers out there. And the tallest living terrestrial animal. So you will not find a creature taller than a giraffe anywhere else outside of Africa. Although this one is not the tallest yet, maybe about 6 months old. I have quite a scattered distribution range compared to a lot of other animals, and some of that is to do with people, but more to do with their specific habitat requirements. So you get vast gaps without any giraffe, and then they start again. So if you take the Miombo Belt, so Miombo is a type of woodland. It's the largest dry woodland in the world, as far as I know. It extends all the way from northern Botswana, northern Zimbabwe, right through into West Africa to the edge of the Sahel. which is not very good at giraffe country. So a great example of this is that you have giraffe occurring quite frequently and all over the place, up to the Zambezi River. And north of the Zambezi River, apart from the Luangwa Valley, the next place you're going to see a giraffe is in the Serengeti. Well, the southern Serengeti, Mikumi National Park in central Tanzania. So very, very strange that there's these huge gaps. And obviously as, filled with the joy of the afternoon, that little one. So those gaps, unlike with certain species where they've been removed by people, is a habitat requirement that has caused these gaps. Now there's a couple of species that are very distinctly absent from that between the Zambezi and the Rufiji River. Giraffe being the biggest of those. Black-back jackal is another very interesting one. And you have up to the Zambezi River and then nothing again until central Tanzania. Let's just try scoot forward a skosh. Are such graceful animals, and hencing their name, giraffe, and it comes from Arabic, and actually means the one who walks swiftly. Zarafa is the Arabic. So as we try and get into a better position to have a look at this journey of giraffe, Ankypank is wondering what is the purpose of their horns and that fur on top. Well, they're not true horns, they're actually called ossicones. And so their horns are solid bone covered in skin and hair on top. Now, in the females, the use is pretty redundant. They don't really compete with each other. But in males, it's very important. If we go to the second one from the right there, Jandre, that's a young male. And you can already see, was it two young males there? It looks like one, in the middle. You can already see it. The horns aren't as delicate. They're starting to get a bit bigger and they're starting to get the bald spot on top. Now, they're used in fighting. Now, giraffe use their long neck as a pivot, and they swing their heads and the top side of those ossicones into the necks of the other giraffe or the other male giraffe that they're battling with. So he's obviously started play sparring already, and you can already see that the hair is becoming worn. Now you also start noticing, oh, there we go, Jandre was looking for a giraffe with the sunset, and he's managed to just find the setting sun sneaking through the clouds. He's looking very impressed with himself at the moment, but well done, Jandre. There's your giraffe sunset shot. I think Viram and Brian and have got better, though. No, I'm only teasing. So there we go, and that giraffe is at the moment feeding off one of our only evergreens. It's going to be very important as the winter months set in, the buffalo thorn. So Michael is wondering whether the patterns, oh, there we go, a little jog from the youngster. The patterns in giraffe differ in different parts of Africa. They do, and there's quite a lot of argument about the speciation in giraffe and how many subspecies or different species there are. And they have very distinct different versions depending where in Africa you might be. So there we go, there's an example. So there's said to be the Angolan and the southern giraffe, but they're pretty similar. And you can see these are the different family trees here, and leading to the different skin patterns. Now, there you go, the orange here is the Maasai giraffe, and that's seen in the Serengeti in Masai Mara. Then you have the reticulated giraffe, which is that there, which is very, very distinct. And then the Rothschild, which is one of the most rare of the giraffe species, due to where they live, and that's actually from human pressure and civil wars in the southern Somalia. And then the West African giraffe that occurs in the Sahel zone. And you'll find there's huge gaps between these different populations. So there's the perfect example of what I was talking about. The Zambezi Valley pretty much runs, you can actually see it running there. And then there's not a giraffe between the Zambezi Valley and the Rufiji River in central Tanzania. And there we are, there's the different giraffe patterns for Africa. Really interesting, great question there, Michael. And you got me, I was on my way to getting there and you were too quick for me. But they're moving off in, let's just try to stick with them a little bit longer. Joan, I spotted another one here. Joan in Washington's wondering, do giraffes have very tight family units like elephants do? Not at all. They're a bit wishy-washy with their family units, and they do change quite often. But normally you will find groups of females and their youngsters together. The males are quite often solitary unless there's a female oestrus to look for. So. But they don't stay together nearly as tightly as elephants. And we can hear one of my favorite calls in the African bush in the early morning and the late afternoon. Now, I know a lot of you out there know it. Let's see if you guys have forgotten your bird calls or you still know them. So if you know what bird is making those calls, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So for now, there are only two different members of the giraffe family left in Africa. In the fossil records, there were a lot more. There were over 10. And probably one of the most interesting for me, it's probably, I'm just trying to remember now how old it was. Now, this was also the closest relative of the modern-day Akapi, but they were incredibly large, massive beasts, and they actually had multiple ossicones. But at the moment, only two left from all of them that used to be there, and there's just a quick idea, the fossil of Sanctheriaeum, the largest ever of the giraffe species that existed, and you can see how massive that skull and horns were. Now, they lived in South Central Europe all the way through to the east into China, believe it or not. So giraffe species were quite once widespread. Oh, look, there's a little bit of dominance going on between two young boys. And we might see a little bit of a head swing. He started one, but no, stop now. More interested in feeding. Basically, what happened is, as the climate throughout the world changed, particularly with Europe, and it got colder, a lot of those species became extinct, while the African ones managed to survive. So, Virginia is wondering, do they ever fight to the death over females? It is possible that they might get an injury that could result in death from their fights, but it's very unusual for them to fight to the death for females. Generally, it is quite obvious who is the winner in those situations. Okay, well, we're going to leave the giraffe to munch on. And I think before it gets completely dark, I know the guys checked the hyena den a little bit earlier, but it wasn't active. But I think we'll go have a squiz, see maybe it's a little bit later that there is some activity there. While we head back towards the second most dominant carnivore in the Sabi Sands, let's go back to Jamie, who's with the most dominant, but also quite often the most sleepy.
And still with our dominant nocturnal predator, the lion. She's currently, this female's been the one who's demonstrated the most restless behavior so far. She seems to be in the process of cleaning her feet once again. I'm still, I think that if these lionesses do decide to get up, she will be the one that initiates it. Maybe making sure she cleans in between her toes, using her teeth in places to pick off the ticks that have settled underneath in that sensitive skin. Another big yawn. Just in that brief glimpse of her teeth, you can see that it's a young lioness. They're in perfect condition. Now look at that intent. Okay, I was about to say that intent stare. But you might have spotted something. There is, of course, always the possibility of a hapless animal wandering in across this lion sighting. Look at the intensity in that gaze. She's heard something. She's not quite sure what it is. She's just watching. Oh. Back to cleaning. Time for a clean around the belly as well. Now, Carol, as we watch our lionesses lounging about, you're wondering about the other pride that we see regularly in this area, and that is the Styx females. You're wondering if any of them have cubs, and the answer is, having a nibble of the grass there. The answer is, Carol, yes, one of the Styx female has had cubs. Another big yawn. She's had cubs around the property to the south of us. It's a property called Vessels. And she's denning in a drainage line there. Which, of course, is wonderful news. We're all thrilled. I don't know how many cubs there are. Not entirely sure. That remains to be seen. And that, for now, that den site is closed off to any vehicles coming to view those cubs. The other two were found with her this morning around that property. So it's still not clarified if any of the others have given birth or not. And on the same subject, Tim, you were wondering, are any of these females pregnant? And the answer is, if they are, they are not nearly as late stage as the Styx females were. In other words, if they are pregnant, it's still very, very early, maybe a couple of weeks, a month at the most. They're not showing any signs of pregnancy yet. Their nipples are not swollen. There you go. Thank you, girl. Perfect view before she rolled over and turned her back on us.
So their nipples are not swollen. There's one with slightly more physically extended nipples than the others, but I don't think that that is due to pregnancy. And of course, with lionesses, they're in the same pride. They will try and synchronize their estrous cycles so that they give birth at the same time, or not exactly at the same time, but within weeks of each other. And therefore, there's more than one set of, there's only one female to help care for the cubs. This is a lion pride that we have kept very careful track of. And I mentioned the fact that they have been through some tumultuous times over the last few months. And Chantal, you were wondering on the subject of our lion dynamics, why is it that we see several groups of females and not mixed groups? And the answer is that is actually the way that lions work in the wild. A lot of documentaries, in order to sort of make the story a bit easier to explain, and a lot of course, The Lion King being the prime example, give the impression that a lion pride is made up of a dominant male or two dominant males and their females. That's not actually how it works. Oh, big stomach scratch. And I think the time has come for the ladies to get up. Big yawns. Couple of sneezes. It was the female that was licking herself that initiated this movement. Oh, look at that traditional head rub greeting. Sorry, Chantal. I'm just going to have to put your question on the back burner for 1 second while this lioness decides what she's going to do. Oh. She's going to sit on her pride member. That's sort of what I was, the behavior that I was describing of that female, of the subadult female. Sorry, Chantal. So how lion dynamics actually work is that a pride will have its own home range and territory, an area that they move about in, and there will be, they will sort of share a boundary with different other prides of the area. They might be related to each other, they might not be. Either way, they keep fairly separate from each other. A group of males, whether it is a single or a group of two, three, and up to five, for example, we have a group of five here, will then have an even larger territory that overlaps the territories of several different females. And I'll use this as an example. The Birmingham Boys are five males that have recently taken over this area. They roam about in a territory, roughly, if I had to guess, would be about the size of 8,000 hectares. The Nkuna's home range and territory, so the core defended part of their home range, is probably about half of that. So the Birmingham Boys overlap with the Nkuna's, they overlap with the Sticks. And they might overlap with other lion prides as well. And what they will do is they will move between the females if the females come into estrus. They might occasionally meet up for kills or for social occasions when they're in an area. But other than that, they move about on their own, defending their territory, calling and scent marking as they go along in order to keep other males from coming in and being a threat to the females and their offspring. So lions don't guard, a male lion does not guard one pride. We've spoken about the high mortality rate of lion cubs and leopard cubs as well, but Erlene, you were wondering, is there any chance that the Nkuhumas would kill Sticks cubs or the Sticks would kill Nkuhuma cubs, or vice versa? And that, of course, is because they could be competition to each other. The answer is it is relatively unlikely, but it does occasionally occur that lionesses will kill cubs from another pride in order to reduce competition to their own. I'm just going to take this opportunity to rearrange our light. Here we go. Whoopsie. Sorry, everyone. I'm trying to shuffle about the car, and I nearly fell out of it. But it's okay. We have regained footing. So, Earline, you were wondering about that. It does occasionally occur. It does occasionally occur, but very, very seldom that they actually... And that's one of the reasons why females choose den sites not in an area where they might overlap with females sharing the territorial boundary, because, of course, territory boundaries are fluid things. And the animals might move about in different ways through there. So they pick parts where they are right in the center of their territory and where they are protected. And a lot of the time, lioness prides in a neighboring area are quite often related to each other. So they start to move off. Lioness prides sometimes split, either when they become too large or when a takeover is being conducted and there are females with young cubs that try and flee the area. Because males, when they conduct a takeover, will move in and actually kill the cubs of the previous dominant males. Look at that beautiful face. Now let us see if these lionesses decide to be on the move. I think they are going to. But while they make that decision, let's head over to Brent and find out what is happening on quarantine.
So great to have the wildebeest herd back on quarantine. And it is going to be quite an interesting couple of weeks with the wildebeest at the moment as they start their annual rut. And there will be much interesting behavior. Jamie said she saw some fascinating stuff with you guys this morning with the wildebeest on quarantine. Now, they've been off feeding through the woodland and they've now moved back onto quarantine as it's got darker. Now, the reason for this, a nice big open area gives them a bit of a chance to see predators before they actually come upon them. We can hear lots of wonderful birds starting to get, the nocturnal birds starting to get going. You have the little scops owlets. Broop. Oh. Broop. Well, Crystal, speaking about birds, oh, look there, someone's just arrived. There's a male coming in. There he is. You can sort of see him. He's just come in from the left-hand side. Now that one's just stood up. And you can see there's going to be lots of interesting behavior. Oh, anyway, before I forget, Crystal in California, well done. Spot on. The bird was indeed Shelley's Franklin. Oh, she says, as I know it, the beer can bird. There we go. This is what we're talking about. The rut has started. Well done, Crystal. Shelley's Franklin. So the males are going to be competing heavily for females at the moment. They might not be quite ready to mate just yet, but that's not going to stop them trying. So these male wildebeest defend a set area, and the females will move between different males' areas. So they will try every advantage to try be able to mate with them before they decide to move through to the next wildebeest bull's patch of land. So there's a reason we won't be putting any spotlights on the wildebeest. They are a diurnal animal, and if we do that, it can temporarily blind them. So we do apologize if it is a bit dark, but there is some interesting behavior going on. So Chantal is wondering, or asking us to remind her, what is it called when the light shines from an animal's eyes? Well, we just call it the reflection, but it's shining off the tapetum lucidum, which is that film there that that's what we use to spot the animals when we're driving around with the spotlights at night. And Wildebeest actually is walking quite close to the vehicle, so they're picking up the light from the car. Now, a very specialist grazer, and they'll only eat short grass and very specific species of short grass. Yeah, that one's coming even closer again. Sorry, I was trying to turn off my other side light because otherwise someone's going to drive into it and I might blind them and cause them to miss the road. A beautiful African scene there. Sorry, I'm just going to have to move slightly just to let the other car pass. Hello, hello. Hello, Michael. How are you? How was your leave?
It was good.
Good. Mike from Cheetah Plains is next to us. We're enjoying the wildebeest as well. Oh, there's a bit of dust bathing to the left there, Jean-André. Any luck this afternoon?
No, but in Gala and Gonza, we did pick up on those nine tracks, but unfortunately we couldn't pick up which block they turned into. So.
Okay, well, maybe you'll find them on the way home.
Yeah, maybe.
Cheers. And as I said, it's going to be fascinating watching the wildebeest rut progress over the next little while. And having a nice little dust bath before bed. So they're probably going to bed down and ruminate right here on quarantine. So I might be able to hear them all the way from the Juma cam, that doing, doing. Or if they get disturbed by a predator, some snorting. Now, I'm going to do something a little naughty, but and then often snort back at you. But he's not doing it today, but you'll hear that if they see a predator, or sometimes if they just see anything, they're not sure if they snorted it. Okay, well, I think it's a bit too dark to continue watching these guys. Let's see if we can go find some nocturnal creatures that don't mind a spotlight. That little Scops owlet calling down here somewhere. I'm going to see if we can find him. We have managed to find one I think it was probably a week or two ago. Beautiful little owl, the smallest owl species we get out here. While we try to find some of the smaller things, back to Jamie with the big ones.
Our lionesses have thought about getting up several times this evening. Apparently, the thought is just too much to bear right now. I think they're waiting because it is a clear night. They're going to be waiting for it to get fully dark before they move out and about. Enjoying those last precious few moments of rest before the night ahead. These two, the sub-adult and the female, have been grooming each other beautifully. And all in all, demonstrating even more clearly a lion pride's lack of personal space. Oh, did your tail flick you there? That was interesting. Her tail thrashed before the itch, or when the itch started, and then she lifted up her head to scratch it on her side. And she actually used the tail to flick at that scratch. She's also got scars around her head, this female. We spoke about that healing injury. Those could be tooth marks. I would guess that they are. She She's got marks along her neck as well. But I'm not 100% sure where those injuries have come from, whether or not they came from time spent with the Birmingham boys. One of the females was mating, but I don't think that it's her. Most likely, I think that those injuries were obtained, or could have been obtained, during a kill, during a hunt and a kill. Animals that are being chased by lions are very prepared to fight back, and they will kick and thrash their horns and thrash their hooves. I'm still looking at her head, though, and those sort of look like bite marks to me. But they're too close together to be canines of, or top canines of a lion. I'm not 100% sure exactly what happened to her, and we'll probably never know. But animals, unlike people, show a tremendous amount of resistance to injuries like that. Not something that is going to concern her terribly much, and it's already completely healed up. Apologies once again, struggling a little bit to hear your questions. So if I get names wrong and the like, please forgive me. And looking at the injuries that this female has, and all of the places that they walk, Zoe was wondering whether or not, or was wondering whether or not ever lionesses ever get bee stings to their paws. I think that's what you asked, Zoe. And the question is, yes, probably they do every now and again. That thick pad, however, is impervious to most things, including most thorns. But the in-between parts of the toes are definitely not. That wound is still quite open, actually. It's quite raw looking. Now that she's twisted her side like that. That looks like a puncture wound. There's a deeper part of it. I wonder what she had a scrap with. Could be hyenas as well. A large group of hyena. I haven't seen them in this particular area come into such physical contact with lion prides, however. But maybe if they found her on her own or in a group of two, there is that possibility as well. Now, two of them having some good yawns and cleaning themselves. And this is a clear sign that in the next few moments they should be getting up. The female at the back now starting her yawns as well. This is how I often feel. Oh, big stretches at the back. First thing in the morning, there's that perfect cat stretch. Limbering up. And here we go. Off into the night. Where to, ladies? Which way are we going to go? She's stopping for a quick urine break, as are they all, actually, before they head off. Bear with me one second, I need to just get onto the Game Drive channel. The stations, these Ngala, now look as though they're getting ready to go mobile east. Okay, copy. It is on the northern side of Knobthorne Open, but the pan that leads from Knobthorne Open to Red Dam, you should see, or the road from there, you should see our lights. Copy that.
that, no problem. They look as though they might head towards the open itself. Look at her phlegm and grimacing there. She was testing the scent of the other lioness's urine, pulling it into the organ of Jacobson. Moving across to the lioness in front of her. And just to describe what I meant by that, she pulled up her upper lip up towards her nose, almost like a snarl. And that's a way of drawing the scent in and up to an organ that is specialized to interpret the scents that the lion is drawing into its mouth. And off we go. Here we go, out on the hunt. Just to let you know, there are other vehicles that are wanting to join this sighting. At the moment, we have one other person with us. There is a third on its way. Oh, I forgot I need to immobilize the vehicle. That's not very helpful. I've got into bad habits since I stopped while I was driving windy. Alrighty, here we go. Through the bush. And on an adventure with the lionesses of Arethusa and Juma. Anybody duck, wash your heads. Okay there, Brian?
Yep.
Awesome. Stop. Lioness has actually spotted something. Let's just take our lights off. There's something that they've spotted. So I've turned my lights off and they're hunting. Sorry, we've got to just sit in darkness. You see their body language change, crouch down. I know it's very dark, but it's one of the things that we just have to do. There's obviously an animal on the clearing, and I just want to chat to the other guy in the game drive vehicle, stationed with the Angola for Jamie. Can you see what they've spotted there? Okay, copy. Confirm there's nothing. Interestingly enough, the other vehicle in the station has a much clearer view of what these lionesses can see, and he says there's nothing here. We're standing by. I had tracks for some of them crossing, and we had Shlambi and Nari on Philemon's cut line this afternoon. Okay, now initially the reason... Sorry, hold on 1 second. Standing by? Sorry, Brian. Copy, thanks. Okay, so the lionesses are not nearly as foolish as we are. Now, I'm afraid, comes a waiting game. We have to sit in the dark because we don't want to give the lionesses away. We don't want to give the impala away. So we're going to sit in complete darkness and we just have to wait and we have to listen. And that's why the lionesses all of a sudden went down into that typical stalking posture. Now, Roy's on the other side of me. He's watching on that side. And we just have to listen and wait for the patience of the lionesses to materialize into a hunt. Fingers crossed they're gonna be successful. They look as though they need it. It's been a long few days, clearly, for the Nguma lionesses. And what's happened here is immediately the lionesses have demonstrated this incredible ability to organize their hunts. And what I mean by that is The one female split off to the right. She's about, I would say, about 20 meters away on my right. The other four went straight ahead on the left, to the left. And they're about 20 meters in that direction. So already, we've got the plan forming. And you'll probably find that the female that's on my right is going to creep around towards the clearing and then chase the wildebeest and try and herd them back towards these lionesses. We've seen them hunt on clearings like this before. So that is what I'm interpreting is going to happen just from what we've observed with them. And of course, for those of you who are familiar with Billy Connolly, or perhaps have been watching Brent's Facebook updates, I showed him that Billy Connolly sketch of the lionesses hunting wildebeest. And now this is all I can think of. That incredible description that he gives of the lioness calling to her pride mates and going, Betty, go that way. You could just imagine the Nkuhumas doing exactly the same thing now. That way. Telling each other on the count of three, they're going to go. I'm joking, of course, but a lioness hunt is so well coordinated and so well handled. And just to let you know, I can still see them. Impalas are rutting, I think. I just heard an impala call off to the right. Yeah, that's their rutting sound. So they haven't spotted the lioness. They don't know that they're here. Remember how we discussed about the impalas? The males getting distracted by each other and the fact that it puts them at risk of attentions from predators. This could be a perfect example. It's just, sorry, I'm just sitting listening to the game drive comms as well. It's just sitting in the quiet for a moment. I just want to hear what's going on exactly. I can see at least one lioness in the darkness ahead of me. Now that impala call that we're hearing now, if it was the call of impala having spotted the lions, there'd be lots of them shouting, bah, bah. Moment is door open. You might have seen them. It sounds as if there's just one lone impala trying to get the rest of them to believe in that there are lions here. No, that sounds more like an alarm call. People that are waiting to get into the sighting. So at some point I am going to need to talk on the game drive, Jim. I'm going to leave it for now. Just take this opportunity to listen. Vehicles is checking as well. It's going to be a very quick check that this lioness is still here. Cool. Sorry. Sorry, Brian. My nerves may be a bit too quick even for you, even with our fantastic cameraman. This is one of the most difficult things for them to film because you have to sit in complete darkness. And we just have to try and describe what we're hearing. Well, the cameramen don't have anything to focus on, anything to look at. It's such a tricky one to balance. calls, the alarm calls of these Impala don't quite sound right. I just keep listening. I'm really hoping for the sake of the Impalas that the Impala haven't seen them. These ladies really do need a meal. Fourth vehicle does want to come and join us. Sorry, hold on one sec. I'll finish that thought in a moment. When a fourth vehicle does want to come and join us, we will have to pull out of the sighting, and that's because we have been here for the longest out of anyone. We've spent quite a considerable period of time with them. And out here, because of the way that things work, we don't want more than three vehicles at a sighting having a negative impact on what's happening with the animals. So every single sighting is limited to a maximum of three, and occasionally, depending on the situation, we might even have two or one vehicles that are allowed in a sighting with an animal. And that's a judgment call that's made by the guides themselves in order to reduce the negative impact that the vehicles have on the animals. Obviously, we want to have utmost respect and as little impact as we can have on their lives. Sorry, guys, bear with me a second. Standing by. It seems like the Wilde are directly south, somewhere around the clearing. The Marla are a little bit more to the west. The other vehicle might have a better idea. What that conversation was about. There's another vehicle that wants to approach, but he wants to check which direction the wildebeest are from the lions versus the lion, versus where he's coming from. Because what he doesn't want to do is, A, scare the lions, well, not scare the lions, but sort of illuminate the lions, or B, chase the wildebeest straight towards them. However, from what I can hear from the other vehicle, who's got a much clearer view than I do, the wildebeest have spotted the lion, so the Impala, and the wildebeest have actually run off, and there's a lion in the middle of the open area. You can see now that spotlight going. So for now, it seems as though the hunt might be over. Obviously, as you can see, we have extended our show ever so slightly. Unfortunately, it is time for us to head out and to move off. There's another vehicle that is approaching, and it's time for us to make space, especially now that this hunt is over. So, for the sunset safari, we can keep our fingers crossed for large and well-fed ngurumas on a kill. I'm going to say a very big thank you to Brian. I'm going to say goodbye on behalf of Brent and Jandre, as well as big thank you to Rebecca, who was directing again this afternoon, her second show. Wherever you are in the world, have a fantastic day, and thank you for joining us, and we will catch you for the Sunrise Safari. Cheers.